My name is Ben Conklin, teacher here in Iredell County, North Carolina, and I am joined by
Regina Yunt, and I am your middle school version. Ben does the high school, and I do the middle school part.
And having both of us with you is great because we see these lessons from both perspectives, high school and middle school. So we are familiar with scaffolding these lessons and making them appropriate for the variety of levels that we teach. This is the first of four webinars that we are hosting over the next month. The series entitled Challenges of Democracy. One of the big challenges of democracy is the free flow of information. You know, you can't have a successful and functioning democratic republic like ours without information. But if you are a believer in free speech and the free flow of information, we do understand that sometimes it can get ugly. Misinformation is also a factor here. So this lesson on the challenge of democracy, specifically focused on information, is going to use the idea of conspiracy theories and the tactic of role play and simulation to drive not just understanding, but higher levels of engagement with your students. As we move on to our second slide here, I wanted to ask all those attending to please type in what your personal definition of a conspiracy theory is. Now, don't look up anything. We don't want any research component here right now. We're simply asking if you would, what is the first thought that comes to mind? What is your idea, your personal definition of a conspiracy theory? The first thing that comes to mind, we just ask that you don't post until we ask you to do so. We know that some might piggyback off of your ideas. We want everyone to have their own post, and then we'll ask in just a minute for everyone to execute at the same time, and we'll see all of these responses come in at once. Now, Regina and I both know that when we use this term with our students, their engagement immediately goes up. Their eyes begin to widen. Turns out everybody loves a good conspiracy theory. And of course, the more engagement we have from our students, often a representation of how much they're actually going to be capable of learning. Regina and I believe that all students are capable of learning, but they have to want to learn it. Now, we can only help them so much. They have to meet us halfway. And one of the great things about many of the lessons that the Constitutional Rights Foundations offer is that they do drive high levels of student engagement.
There's always a hook.
There's always a hook. Not only do the lessons start with a hook, but the format of the lessons themselves are a hook.
They really require active engagement on the student part, which always makes it more exciting.
Now, the title of this Challenge of Democracy Information in some way is embodied in the little graphic that we see on this slide. The gentleman reading a newspaper that is on fire. Now, it turns out that, as I mentioned earlier, you can't really have a functioning democracy without information. Citizens have to be informed, or we will lose the republic that we've created in the United States and that we've seen develop around the world. But one of the drawbacks of the free flow of information is that sometimes bad information is disseminated, and people then make bad decisions, even if attempting to make good decisions, but they're making decisions based on bad information. And even with the best intentions, you ultimately do not come to the best conclusions or results if your decisions were driven by bad information. So this lesson, Conspiracy Theories Role Play, is focusing on the free flow of information and how sometimes it can be good and bad.
Did you want them to put in their definitions now?
Yeah, go ahead and please input your definition in your mind. What is a conspiracy theory? Go ahead and post those in the text box. We're going to extract some of them. This will hopefully lead to some common understanding amongst all of our participants. We definitely look forward to seeing what was in your mind's eye.
Oh, this is a good one. It could be a logical conclusion based on limited knowledge, or it could be a wild story that has no foundation in truth at all.
That's true. There is a spectrum. Like many things, conspiracy theories are on a spectrum. Some are grounded in truth or individual facts. Others, perhaps wildly inaccurate and inappropriate, and seem to have no basis in reality. You know, we're going to spend a lot of our time navigating this spectrum, but our ultimate goal here is to equip students with the skills necessary, not just to identify what a conspiracy theory is, but to digest information in a healthy way so that they can use this information to drive good decisions. Ultimately, our democracy or any republic democracy cannot function without citizens who are knowledgeable and put that information to good use. What else do we have here, Regina?
Also have unsubstantiated suspicion and doubt of the official narrative.
Ooh, that's a good one. Yeah, I think many conspiracy theories, that's their starting point, right? For some of us, our default is skepticism against any position of authority. And we'll discuss today that that can often be a very healthy thing. We know history is full of examples of whether it be governments, corporations, whatever, trying to use information in a way to control people, but we can't be overly skeptical as well.
And here's Cassidy's, a theory regarding an event or a topic that is controversial, but may have some evidence to support it.
Excellent. And that is really the heart of the activity we do today. Today we challenge students to decipher their own understanding of a particular activity and decide for themselves whether or not a conspiracy theory is really at work. Now, as we move on to our next slide, I do want to thank anyone that contributed to that. We did extract three really good examples, and they seem to keep coming. Feel free to browse through those as we move forward. But I do want to discuss this spectrum that we had just mentioned. You know, there does lie an individual that is willing to believe everything they're told, whether it's because they are extremely gullible or they're being told information from a source that they already believe in or subscribe to. It might not be overly healthy to believe everything that we see. In fact, many times entire nations have been led off a cliff, so to speak, because like sheep, they were willing to follow the information being given to them by the authoritative sources they came from. Of course, on the other end of the spectrum, it's not healthy to not believe in anything and always be overly skeptical or disregard what might be good information. Our challenge is to understand that the truth is out there, as shown by one of our favorite series, X-Files. But with the help of some insights from the Belford Center at the Harvard Kennedy School and a gentleman by Nick Pope, I did want to give an overview of this important concept, that conspiracy theories may lie on a spectrum, but the heart of the matter is that information is there. The truth is there, or maybe not. Our students can't understand that until they're equipped with the skills necessary to understand this for themselves. We know that in a democracy, allowing individuals to seek out, receive, and even give information is a critical tool for active citizenship. Just like this lesson is all about being active in the classroom, active citizenship is key to a healthy, functioning democratic republic, much like our own. The free flow of information is necessary. We have to use it to evaluate and fight corruption. It enables participation in all facets of public life. It makes governments more efficient and accountable. It even, in an economic sense, might encourage investment, which spurs economic growth. But basically, it helps people exercise their fundamental human right of free speech. So again, although we are on a spectrum here, we do understand that somewhere in the middle of being overly skeptical or believing everything lies the important skill of active citizenship and thinking critically on your own. I know Regina and I both often encourage our students not to believe everything they hear. And often we do not care what their personal beliefs are. We just care that they have reasons to back up why they believe what they do. And the heart of this lesson, again, is to equip students with the skills necessary to evaluate information and come to their own understanding that is grounded in logic more than anything else. So we know that historically governments have sought to limit information that their citizens receive. It's often used as a control mechanism. But informed citizens are harder to control, right? That's why they oftentimes governments will try to control information. Informed citizens ask tough questions to people in power that may not want the answer. And of course, now with technology advancements, especially the internet at large, we have the free flow of information on a scale that we have never before seen, what some might call the information revolution, if you will. Although healthy for a democracy, though, there can be a darker side to the free flow of information, as it might even be weaponized, used to undermine understanding and trust in democratic processes, which, of course, are the foundation of what our government relies on. On the other hand, you know, we encourage behavior. They could encourage behavior that otherwise would not occur or maybe lead to bad consequences. So citizens must be familiar with the tactics used to distort or even exploit information, sometimes used to serve only special interests or certain actors, whether we ultimately deem them good or bad. So the integrity, even the legitimacy of our particular system of government depends on citizens able to evaluate information and think critically for themselves, not to fall victim to wild conspiracy theories, but also to understand that there often is truth among what may seem to be scandalous or information that might automatically be disregarded otherwise. So that leaves us kind of with a double-edged sword. The free flow of information is key to a healthy citizenry, but can easily be used to disseminate bad ideas and promote the spread of wild conspiracy theories that maybe curb critical thinking and sound decision making. I mean, the fact is that some conspiracy theories do turn out to be true. And while governments don't lie as often as many people might seem to think, there is historical evidence to suggest that they do conceal true motives and sometimes spin information to fit a particular agenda. Therefore, a healthy skepticism in respect to what we're being told by government or advertisers, corporations, any source of authority can be a good thing. It's sometimes a healthy indicator of a modern democratic society. More generally, it's good in terms of critical thinking, as we've been mentioning, which is what we should strive to promote with our students. Our goal is to equip our students with the tools necessary to think critically on their own.
Oh, we've got two great examples from our audience. So Evan talks about, have either of you used some of these conversations in conjunction with a literature class reading of Orwell's 1984?
That's a classic example, a great book to use. I've even wondered in the past how that book sometimes isn't banned already. It really does a good job of allowing students to think critically and make connections to our world today. And this lesson really, you know, we keep using this term conspiracy theory, but the real heart of this lesson is identifying what's commonly referred to as logical fallacies. And when students can understand and recognize logical fallacies, they see it in all modes of literature. Not just in 1984, but many other great works as well, or any particular resources that you ultimately choose to bring into the classroom.
And Cassie brings up the FBI letter to Martin Luther King Jr., as well as Brave New World.
Oh, perfect. Excellent. Yeah, I know I have two colleagues of mine in the English department that do use those resources specifically. I used just recently Martin Luther King's letter from a Birmingham jail as well, and he was using that letter to combat other logical fallacies about, you know, racial issues of the time.
Misinformation.
So conspiracy theories can be good, but they, as we know, can also be extremely unhealthy in terms of people maybe believing completely unsubstantiated rumors and leading to beliefs or actions that should never have manifested to begin with. As we move on, though, we realize that the trick is to get the balance right. As the old saying goes, it's good to have an open mind, but not so open that your brain falls out, right? We want to have a healthy skepticism and be capable of thinking critically. Students have to learn to think critically to understand the mechanisms that are used to promote false logic or to manipulate them, to lie to them in some speak. I try to get across to my students that they will be lied to by people trying to exploit them, and it's their job to be able to navigate that difficult terrain. So in this lesson, taking this right from the introduction of the lesson itself, students learn how to identify conspiracy theories and to distinguish them from other questions about history or current events. First, students discuss a hypothetical conspiracy. Next, students complete a thorough reading about historical and contemporary conspiracy theories, as well as ways to identify frequently used logical fallacies by conspiracy theorists. Finally, students role play federal investigators determining if a set of facts amounts to a conspiracy theory. So bringing us back to this spectrum that we talked about earlier, it might not be too good to believe everything and be led down ridiculous paths. It equally might not be good to believe or to not believe anything that comes to us from a position of perceived authority. It's our job to equip our students with the skills necessary to allow them to think critically and navigate active citizenship in an appropriate way. Abraham Lincoln once said, "I'm a firm believer in the people. If given the truth, they can be depended upon to meet any national crisis. The great point is to bring them the real facts." Now, thanks to technology and the internet particularly, we have a vehicle to deliver real facts to people. But this vehicle can also drive on the wrong side of the road and bring in people bad information that they are fully capable of acting upon. So Abraham Lincoln is right. People can be relied on to make good decisions and promote a healthy republic. But at the same time, we can be led astray. That's our job as educators. We are the first line of defense, equipping our students with the skills needed so that Abraham Lincoln can be proved correct. So I wanted to bring us back to the idea of simulations and role plays and why they work so well. Regina and I both use Constitutional Rights Foundation's resources regularly, especially the ones that deal with simulations and role plays, because ultimately what's at work here is experiential learning, what many people call active learning. It's learning by doing, which automatically makes students more engaged and ultimately walk away with more understanding and the ability to make connections between what they just learned and what they already knew. And we know as educators that that is probably the most important thing to cement real long-term understanding and the ability to put these skills into action.
So for my middle schoolers, I always talk about making things sticky, making it stick to their mind. And when they're actually doing it and participating in it, they're always bringing themselves back to that. And they'll refer back to that role play or that civil conversation where they were actively engaged. So you know that they really have it and that they're using it, that connections you were talking about.
The hard part with using these lessons is not getting the students involved. The hardest part for me is actually sometimes them being overly involved and having to recalibrate and bring the discussion back to the confines of the actual content we're trying to deliver. Students get so excited using great lessons like this conspiracy theory one that our biggest task is to keep them in line, right? To keep them on task.
True. And that goes back with that safe environment. is helping them explore different points of view. That's really valuable when they do the role plays. And they just really get into that role playing and being that person. And lots of times I love it when they add their own language and make their own connections, even separate from what's on the page.
Actually, I often worry that sometimes we're within the confines of a textbook or a particular curriculum too much. These lessons offer us the opportunity to expand far beyond that with lasting impressions on our students.
And you're really shocked with some of the students that get so deeply into it. I've really enjoyed seeing some of my sometimes quieter students come alive in a situation like this.
I will admit that two lessons in particular with students that generally are not involved that have come from the Constitutional Rights Foundation, this one on conspiracy theories and a moot court activity of the Greenwood versus California case, I was very surprised at the level of engagement that students brought to the classroom using these activities. Again, high engagement, right? I hate to keep saying the same thing over and over again, but I can't really understate how much this really affects them, ultimately leading to high retention. They do have long-lasting understanding, and I'm not interested in teaching my students something that they're going to forget in 6 weeks or 6 months. You know, I'm really good at going over vocabulary and things like that, but if our students don't really have high lasting retention, how are we really helping them, right? We're not really serving them as well as we should be if we think that we're promoting maybe just vocabulary lists and there's not real understanding going on.
And I think the creativity that this brings is really what helps them with that high retention as well. You know, they are creating something for themselves, which makes it sticky.
And we need to remind them that creativity is a mark of intelligence. the basic recall that many of us spend time, you know, focusing on and hammering in the students, that's not the only thing that really shows intelligence. Students are emboldened when they realize that they are capable of being on par with their peers who maybe sometimes they thought they really couldn't keep up with. This is just another opportunity for them to showcase their level of individual expertise on a particular subject.
Yeah, their creativity leads to that depth in the critical thinking connection.
Excellent. So role plays work, bottom line. Role plays work, and one of the fears is that they take too much time, that we don't really we can't really afford to spend the time that it takes. If we use role plays and simulations purposefully, we are doing our students a service. And we shouldn't look at this as necessarily like an extra thing that we can do once in a while. The more we can incorporate these kinds of activities in our normal schedules, the better it seems to be for our students. The ingredients for success that makes this and many other lessons from the Constitutional Rights Foundation work so great is, one, we start with an inquiry, a question that normally students are already kind of interested in. Of course, the inquiry for this lesson is about a particular conspiracy theory and whether or not it is justified. But we start with a question that captures their imagination and a lot of times already brings in prior knowledge that they come to the class with. But we then provide context. We give them background and we start this lesson with now a common understanding of some important context and background information. We move on to the use of a simulation, where they, again, bring in this engagement and activity. And finally, the last ingredient for success that we find throughout many of the lessons from the Constitutional Rights Foundation is the one that many of us try to overlook. Perhaps we go through the lesson and we feel like we're running out of time or something, but perhaps the most important, to debrief and make connections with our students. We're trying to achieve a good discussion with our class once these lessons are over. And I can speak firsthand that many of these discussions go down avenues and lead into areas that otherwise would have remained unexplored. But because of the simulation and the context that we previously provided, the discussion blossoms and students learn even more than I had expected them to begin with.
So just to piggyback on that, especially from the middle school point of view, the students get lost in the simulation, being creative, and it's very exciting for them. However, I feel like it's really important to bring them back to the main point with that debrief and help make them connections. Some of your students are going to do it automatically. You can see them making the connections right as you're doing the activity with how they're reaching out. For others, you have to kind of connect the dots.
Right, true. Well, if we do it correct, if we incorporate all of these four ingredients, the students are really benefiting and their understanding is skyrocketing. The sky is really the limit as they use this new understanding and move forward. So we wanted to give us the opportunity to experience a version of the lesson that you would use in class if inclined to do so. Now, the first part of this lesson is a reading that you would do with the class, perhaps maybe assign it as homework or annotate it together in class. And I think, Regina, I know as a middle school teacher, with some of the resources available to us from the Constitutional Rights Foundation, it is appropriate to work on annotation skills because sometimes the reading levels are a little bit more above than maybe the students that we're dealing with at that particular time.
Yeah, for me, this would definitely be something I would have to do in class. The reading level is too high for even most of my advanced students. However, chunking it, breaking it down, doing some scaffolding, instead of, we're going to be looking at six different logical fallacies, mm-hmm. Break it down into two simple ones and then, give the others just kind of orally or as you go and kind of point those out. But those are ways to make this more middle school ready versus high school.
And we're going to point you to where you find these resources at the end of our webinar. But instead of reading the full handout that you could go over in class or assign as homework, we are going to extract some of the key pieces of information and go over some of the logical fallacies that were so adeptly incorporated into this reading. So to experience the model using the idea of conspiracy theories, past and present, you would use part A, the class reading. Now, we already discussed when this webinar began what our personal definitions of what a conspiracy theory really is, and we have some common understanding now. Your students will be left in the same place after reading conspiracy theories past and present. So some of these logical fallacies that are incorporated into this lesson, we wanted to just name them quickly. And if you would, as we go through them, just jot down the titles of these logical fallacies, because we are going to revisit them later on in a quick activity where we might ask you to remind us what some of these were and which ones you saw evident in our conspiracy theory role play. So again, this would be the providing context portion of the lesson. And in the context, it gives us some of these logical fallacies. The first, known as anecdotal evidence. And we're going to go over them in a little bit more detail, but again, I'm just labeling them for you now. If you would, when they're all done, you can take a screenshot or go ahead and scribble them down right now, because we are going to revisit them shortly. Anecdotal evidence is a very popular logical fallacy used in all kinds of aspects of daily life. Also, cherry-picking data. We see a common logical fallacy is false cause, and some of us might already be thinking of examples of this. I know when I see some of this terminology, my brain immediately goes to examples evident in our lives today. We see that slippery slope, in my opinion, one of the more common forms of logical fallacies, begging the question, and also, I'm going to need your help on this one, Regina. I apologize. Personal
incredulity.
My tongue just doesn't work that way. I can't say it correctly. I appreciate you.
It's a five-syllable word. Give a student that can pronounce it a bonus point, right?
Yeah, someone gets a star. Yeah, as long as they pronounce that right, they automatically get 100 for the lesson. That's what I do with my students. So these six examples of logical fallacies are incorporated in this Part A reading, Conspiracy Theories Past and Present.
And don't worry if you haven't heard of some of these. You probably know them as different names. When we were doing some of our research, there's several names for many of these. And so as long as they understand the skill, it's not really important what the name is.
Right. And the reading itself is followed by a few class discussion questions that are used to reinforce the main points of the reading. So you'll use that in whatever you deem to be an appropriate way with your students as you go over the reading itself. So we wanted to look at a series of quotes that show, again, the spectrum of conspiracy theory ideology and how sometimes people do approach it from different perspectives. Alan Moore is a famous graphic novelist. Some of his work has been turned into feature films. Alan says, "The main thing that I learned about conspiracy theory is that conspiracy theorists believe in a conspiracy because that is more comforting. The truth of the world is that it is actually chaotic. The truth is that it is not the Illuminati or the Jewish banking conspiracy or the gray alien theory. The truth is far more frightening, that nobody's in control." So some of us might gravitate towards believing and subscribing to conspiracy theories because deep down it makes us think that somebody is in actual control and the alternative is far more scary. Whereas one of my favorite investigative journalists, Matt Taibbi, he says, "Conspiracy theorists of the world, believers in the hidden hands of the Rothschilds and the Masons and the Illuminati, we skeptics owe you an apology. You were right. The players may be a little different, but your basic premise is correct. The world is a rigged game." So maybe Matt approaches this from a little bit different part of the spectrum we talked about earlier, that many people might get something specifically wrong, but their basic understanding that some things are being manipulated in certain circumstances, that has proven to be correct. But what we're asking our students to do is not necessarily believe one or these other quotes, but instead maybe focus on a quote from Gore Vidal, a political commentator and I believe novelist, right? Mm-hmm. He says, "I'm not a conspiracy theorist, I'm a conspiracy analyst." Again, that's what we're doing with this lesson here. They're already begin to do this with going over Part A of this lesson, the background reading, but we're trying to equip our students with the skills necessary to identify logical fallacies often used to perpetuate conspiracy theories and lead people in the completely wrong direction.
Yep, that's exactly where we're at. We're asking them to become the analyzers.
We want to embolden them and make them understand that they are fully capable of being these analyzers. Many times people think that, oh, this type of stuff is for people far smarter than me. They got it under the control. What right do I have to question this stuff? That's entirely wrong. We have to go back to Lincoln's quote. We are the only protectors of our republic, of our type of democracy. And unless students understand that they are capable of doing that, our democracy is at risk. So moving on, we capture our students' attention with a hook. Like many of the lessons that the Constitutional Rights Foundations offer us, they start out with a hook, and we're going to start out with a hook with you all as well. Imagine that a friend walked up to you and in a very serious fashion told you that Mount Rushmore was actually carved by people under the control of an extraterrestrial civilization from the Andromeda Galaxy. What's more, the carving of the presidents on Mount Rushmore was intended as a welcome to those extraterrestrials who indeed are coming very soon to the United States. Now, you might immediately think that this friend is showing you their backside or maybe the Canadian view of Mount Rushmore, but you're prompt for the moment. How would you respond to your friend if they approached you and in a serious way said that Mount Rushmore was carved by extraterrestrials or at least extraterrestrials controlling humans as a welcome from extraterrestrials from the Andromeda Galaxy? What would you say? How would you respond to your friend? Take a moment to type what your response might be, and please go ahead and post it in the text box. Now, Regina, I can tell you that I had to remind some of my students in class to only use appropriate responses because I could tell by their faces.
They were getting way too excited.
That their default might be something that we would consider inappropriate in the classroom setting, for sure. So we asked our participants here, how would you respond to your friend if they told you Mount Rushmore was carved by an ancient civilization of humans being controlled by extraterrestrials?
Well, Sean's excited. He's excited for the Andromedan overlords, and he's going to serve them well.
Oh, nice. Yeah. He's going to do exactly what they say, right?
There we go.
So as you think what you might respond to your friend with, you might also be thinking, like, what seems to be wrong with the story? You're going to respond to them a certain way based on what you feel to be wrong with the story they just told you. What, in your view, seems to be wrong with the story that Mount Rushmore is a product of extraterrestrials? What specifically do you think seems to be wrong with the story that Mount Rushmore is the product of extraterrestrials? Regina's chuckling over here, so.
Yeah, Evan's like, well, why did they do it in South Dakota? Why South Dakota? And then, of course, he has a disclaimer, no offense to any South Dakota.
Yeah, I'm not trying to upset anyone.
Why South Dakota, out of all the locations?
That just happened to be a nice exposed piece of canvas. That rock was the best canvas they came across, I guess. What information would we need from our friend to convince us that this story is actually credible or believable? So perhaps you may choose to type in the text box now that what additional information you might need to verify that your friend is indeed credible or this story is believable. Many times when I'm confronted with a story that I think to be unbelievable, you know, I need to ask myself, well, what information would I need to start taking this a little bit more seriously? Now, this obviously is a unique example, but the hook that we're talking about here gets them thinking. It gets them thinking about a type of conspiracy theory and leads us into the heart of the matter, which again is going over some of these logical fallacies.
All right, so Sean has a great segue.
Okay.
To where we're going.
Perfect.
Because I don't think I have an honest response, as there is no way for me to disprove such an out there story.
Mm.
How do you disprove workers weren't controlled by aliens? It just isn't reasonable. Supporting documents and evidence would be needed in order to confirm the story.
Nice, and that's what we want our students to think as well. And if we go over these logical fallacies, we'll be equipping them with the tools they need to decide even if the information or the evidence that we're asking for is credible. So that leads us to the Sagan standard. Carl Sagan says, extraordinary claims, much like the Mount Rushmore backstory slash hook that we just went over, requires extraordinary evidence. If ordinary available evidence cannot support a claim, then it is our default that we must expect extraordinary evidence for the claim. We must produce that. And that's exactly what he's just mentioned.
Evan has a good argument. The burden of proof is all screwed up. Why would we need to prove the theory false rather than they prove it true?
Right.
Looks like that's exactly where we're going with it.
And that's a great connection to some other, you know, important civic understanding that we use in other lessons today about the role of the judiciary and the justice system, burden of proof. So this is, again, a great way to create connections to other things that you might be going over in class, whether social studies or even, English class. So let's get to these specific logical fallacies. The first one we mentioned was anecdotal evidence. Anecdotal evidence is when you use personal experience or even just an isolated example instead of what might be a more uniform valid argument. A lot of times, anecdotal evidence is used in an attempt to discredit other statistics or patterns of evidence that exist. So if you would take a moment to analyze the political cartoon that we feature here, which does a decent job of visualizing the idea of anecdotal evidence. We see anecdotal evidence used all the time in personal conversation, right? You have a conversation with somebody and they say, well, yeah, but I've seen
my aunt's cousin's boyfriend.
Right, exactly. And although that may be true, it's just one example, which could very well be an outlier and not really evidence of a pattern that we should be leaning on.
That's a great math connection right there.
Yeah, there you go. Not my expertise. My wife happens to be the math teacher, so I'll go ahead and leave that to her. So anecdotal evidence was our first example of logical fallacy that was in a very effective way incorporated into Part A, the reading and background information that was provided in this awesome lesson. Next, we come across slippery slope. Slippery slope is asserting that if we allow a specific thing to happen, if we allow A to happen, then Z or something else will automatically consequently happen as well. Sometimes this is called the domino theory. And Regina and I remembered that this type of idea was used quite effectively in a series of advertisements from DirecTV. And some of us may have seen these in the past, but we're going to go ahead and just show a quick little video clip to remind us. This is a great example of what we mean by slippery slope.
When you have cable and can't find something good to watch, you get depressed. When you get depressed, you attend seminars. When you attend seminars, you feel like a winner. When you feel like a winner, you go to Vegas. When you go to Vegas, you lose everything. And when you lose everything, you sell your hair to a wig shop. Don't sell your hair to a wig shop. Get rid of cable and upgrade to DirecTV. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
So the logical fallacy of the slippery slope here is, of course, how do you go from not having cable to all of a sudden selling your hair to a wig shop? That's a slippery slope, right? How one thing ends somewhere that is completely unconnected in any fashion. But slippery slope is something that many of us fall victim to. For some reason, we often see this used, especially with advertisers in not such a comical way. So they wouldn't use this tactic if it wasn't effective, right?
Well, sometimes it's actually true. Sometimes something could lead. Sometimes there is a direct causation.
But that may be
not
anecdotal.
Always. Yeah,
right?
But not always.
Not always. It could very well be anecdotal. So that brings us to our next logical fallacy, the third among this list, cherry picking. Some of us are very good at this, also called Texas sharpshooter. We've seen it referred to as Texas sharpshooter. This is when you only choose data clusters that support your particular argument, or you work really hard to find a specific pattern that fits what you're looking, even though there may be lots of other evidence that disproves it. So if you take a moment, go ahead and analyze this cartoon we have here for you that reinforces the idea of cherry picking. We might be reminded of some ways that we see this incorporated in our daily lives as well. Cherry picking is a very popular tactic used. Moving on, false cause. False cause is presuming that a real or even a perceived relationship between things means that one is the cause of the other. We may have come across this in other terms like faulty cause, non-causa, pro-causa, or even questionable cause. Take a look at the image we have here. Obviously, global warming is happening because look at the style of beachwear, right? Now, we have a little video clip here that we wanted to show you as well that helps reinforce the idea of false cause.
Ernie.
Well, hi, Bert.
You still have that banana in your ear.
What?
I said you still have that banana in your ear.
Yeah, Bert, I know.
You know? Ernie, why is that banana still in your ear?
Listen, Bert, I use this banana to keep the alligators away.
Alligators? Ernie, there are no alligators on Sesame Street.
Right. It's doing a good job, isn't it, Bert?
So Ernie believes that his banana to the ear is keeping all the alligators away. Why? Because he doesn't see any alligators. Now, obviously, there's no direct connection between that banana as being the actual cause of not letting any alligators around, but he makes that connection. It's a false cause. False cause is a very popular tactic used as a logical fallacy in not just conspiracy theories, but many other aspects of our lives.
Sports superstitions.
Yes, sports superstitions, for sure. We came across a lot of those this year with the performance of the Patriots. We found out that Tom Brady has a lot of those in his repertoire. Begging the question, another logical fallacy that comes from the background reading provided in this lesson, sometimes referred to as circular reasoning. This is when the conclusion is included in the premise itself. So the example I wanted to point out here, the rights of the minority are every bit as sacred as the rights of the majority. For the majority's rights have no greater value than those of the minority. It basically just said the same thing twice, right? We used what we said as the reason, as the actual evidence and ultimate conclusion itself. This is begging the question. Circular reasoning is a tactic often used to promote conspiracy theories or just bad information in general. And finally, that leads us to, again, I have to have you say this, Regina.
Personal incredulity.
Yes, declaring an argument invalid because it's difficult to understand. It has to be untrue. Well, if I don't get it, if I don't understand it, how could this possibly be true? And in the classroom setting, we may come across this with our students more than anything else, because we know that a lot of times students can be very combative, like when they feel that they don't understand something, they may be shut down. They're quick to use this personally. Because they don't understand something, oh, well, I don't get it, that can't be right, that can't be true, because they don't want to go through the work of really trying to understand it. But that's what we're doing here, right? We're helping them halfway. We're doing a lot of the work so that they can meet us halfway and they can be equipped with these skills to not only understand these logical fallacies, but see them in action. And then with the second part of this lesson, get involved in the role play to actually use the logical fallacies that we just go over. So that brings us to part B, the conspiracy theory role play. When using this lesson that the CFR offers us, we put groups of students in, we put students in groups of four or five, and they read the directions of a sheet called Conspiracy Busters Handout. And this is a letter from John Krebs that's read aloud with the class or in their groups and is checked for understanding. Now, we have two questions here that we're going to use to check your understanding. And I am going to actually go ahead and, along with you, read this letter from John Krebs. And I invite you, as we go through this letter, to type a response to one of these two questions here. So we're inviting some engagement from our participants right now. And I'm going to go ahead and bring up this letter. And as I go through and read it, again, look at these two questions, choose one of them, and go ahead and please respond in the text box to one of them. So the reading that serves as the launch pad for the actual role play itself. To whom it may concern, my name is John Krebs, MD. I'm about to publish an ebook called Weather Warfare and Energy Weapons. It contains the results of 10 years of research during which I uncovered a plot of enormous danger to the nation. It involves members of the deep state within the Pentagon, the National Security Agency, and other federal agencies. The deep state consists of unelected government officials who act outside the rule of law. In a nutshell, These groups are working together to create high-tech weapons using microwaves to impose mind control on American political dissenters and to change the climate of the United States. Here are just a few of the facts. The Department of Defense has funded research into microwave development for decades. Thousands of American citizens have complained of microwave monitoring, including mind control attempts and other symptoms such as increased anxiety and fatigue while using microwave ovens. Many political protesters have complained of similar symptoms after encounters with riot police. Budco Industries installed a microwave sending station on the coast of South Carolina. That's really close to us, Regina.
I knew it could happen.
On the coast of South Carolina before the appearance of Hurricane Florence in 2018. The United States Air Force has been experimenting with a microwave heat ray for breaking up violent crowds. The Air Force has also published research on weapons to create artificial weather. Files proving the conspiracy have been collected by a government employee with high-level security clearance, who goes by the code name V. These files were destroyed in a fire of mysterious origin, which, quote, fire investigators called a, quote, accident. Fortunately, V has a photographic memory and shares this information and warnings about new weather weapons and the deep state in online forums. So as students in their groups go through and read this letter, again, we're inviting them to try to extrapolate some of the logical fallacies that we had just gone over, or perhaps they would have annotated as they went through the reading. So as we invited you earlier, please respond to one of these two prompts. Can you identify, based on the list of logical fallacies that we had just gone over, any of them at work in John's letter?
Well, this is also something, you know, just as a strategy, using this where students have to use text evidence. I mean, that's something that we work with them every day in middle school. I promise high school teachers, are working on this. But, you know, having them go back in and find text evidence, so they may have some initial reactions where very quickly they come up with number one, like, oh, it can't be because of this, and it can't be because of this. But having them go back and apply the analysis that we've just talked to them about the logical fallacies, that really requires that critical thinking, even at a deeper level.
And the connection to the stimulus material or background information, whatever other resources we're providing. And again, that is similar to what we will be discussing next time in another lesson that uses the civil conversation model. They'll be expected to use the same thing, but we'll talk about that again a little bit later. Do we have any responses popping up?
We do. We've got Slippery Slope from John. The government is researching microwaves and the Air Force is investigating microwave weapons. Does it mean that they're related?
So that was both Sean?
Yes.
So Sean gives us the terminology, but more importantly, backs it up with the explanation of why, right? It's not just good enough to say slippery slope. He is using the evidence from the reading to back it up. So thank you, Sean.
So Cassie follows up with the false cause with the microwave research. That weaponizing, just because they are studying microwaves, are they really weaponizing?
Right, right.
And then Evan followed up with cherry-picking data, the Department of Defense funding research for decades, selective identification of one of thousands of their research topics.
Excellent. So I guess some of us are really already kind of familiar with logical fallacies, or we really took this list and understanding to heart because we're doing a great job of applying some of our understanding to this role play that our students would have been involved in.
And I'm just going to kind of call you guys out. You did a great job. They were very sorry that for circular reasoning. See, Ben's not a part of this. He's over here talking, so he doesn't know what all we've been talking about. But they really thought that we should have a Friends episode as part of circular reasoning. We've been kind of doing lots of connections.
Nice.
Read this later.
Perfect. Well, we do thank you for those of us posting in the text some responses to these prompts. And that shows us part B, where they actually use the conspiracy theory role play. That's part of this great lesson. So that would move us on to part C of the lesson, which is a 3-2-1 exit slip that we give our students as a culminating activity to this role play. And this is where we cement some of our understanding and leave students with our own idea of how far they've come, right? This is what we may use as an assessment tool. Whether you choose to use it maybe as a formal thing or maybe a little bit more informal, or perhaps you use it as a way to drive further discussion. Because as we mentioned earlier, one of the key, and if not maybe the most important ingredient in this tactic, is having the discussion with your class, making those connections. Save time for that component. If you do not utilize that fourth key ingredient, we are undermining our own efforts and not getting as much value added out of these lessons as we otherwise could. The 3-2-1 slip that this lesson provides asks students to give three things that they had learned from the lesson, to invoke two things they want to know more about, and to have one question they have about conspiracy theories. And I know when I used this lesson in my class, that last question was almost every student, and I don't know if I did this wrong or not, but they just asked about other conspiracy theories.
I was going to say, that's exactly right.
Yeah.
So, and that is one thing that you have to do to kind of corral, to make sure that you get through it, is they do want to talk about that very initially and to kind of bring them back to what we're doing at hand. And then if there's time, you can head into some of those later.
Mine came in the next class already bringing up some of the stuff again.
Up.
I was like, all right, well, you know, this is great, but we're going to move on. I tried to use it as a segue into another lesson. But what really we left off with them wanting to do more role play and simulation, and me teaching U.S. history. There's a lot of conspiracy theories throughout the curriculum that students kind of already have some background information on. So it was great for me because I used it as a way to reinforce the actual content and curriculum that is part of the framework that we're supposed to be going over.
You mean
regardless.
The real information?
The real information, oh. Yeah. but this is where you'll see the light bulbs really start going off, right? When we use the exit strategies like this one, the 3-2-1 exit slip that the Constitutional Rights Foundation provides in this awesome lesson. So, with that, you have been shown the three components of this amazing lesson, the article that serves as background and context, the actual role play itself, and the culminating 3-2-1 exit slip. So now with a basic understanding of this resource and how you can use it in your classroom, we wanted to make sure that you know where to find this and some of the many other great resources that the Constitutional Rights Foundation offers us for free. Go figure, right? That must be a conspiracy theory. Great lessons offered for free? I don't believe it. Well, turns out that it is true, and we're going to show you where to find it right now. So on your screen, you see the URL, and I believe in the text box, you might also see a link that you could actually just click on. But as you go to www.crf-usa.org, we're going to ask that you /the-challenge-of-democracy, because that leads us to the website that showcases all of the lessons that are part of this Challenges of Democracy series. Now, the one that we focused on tonight was information, and here we see it offered conspiracy theories past and present, the PDF of the lesson plan itself that teaches you how to go through it with your students, the background reading, the actual role play itself, and the 3-2-1 exit slip strategy. It also includes a mini PowerPoint that can be used with the hook that we used in our example tonight with Mount Rushmore. So, with these resources now at your disposal, we encourage you, find the time to use role plays and active learning strategies, because they will help deliver the content and create lasting understanding with your students. And you know, they might actually want to show up to class next time. So among these and other great resources that the Constitutional Rights Foundations give us, we did want to offer real quick two other resources that go along with the idea of logical fallacies, and those are shown to you on our last slide here as well. There are two more URLs. One, a free resource, Book of Bad Arguments. It gives definitions and some graphics.
Extended examples.
Yeah, these are basically extension materials that can help reinforce the ideas of logical fallacies so that they can understand them and then identify them in other things in their daily lives that might be trying to manipulate them or lie to them. Because as I mentioned earlier, as citizens, we need to understand that there are those who are trying to manipulate us. Maybe it's a politician trying to get us to vote a certain way. Maybe it's a news anchor that's trying to hide information. Maybe it is an advertiser trying to get us to purchase a product or a service that we don't really need. There are all kinds of instances where logical fallacies or bad logic is used to make citizens do things that they otherwise would not have do. It's our responsibility as educators to make this beyond evident to our students and equip them with the skills necessary to identify them. So,
speaking of selling things, that last one has a slash shop, but if you scroll down at the bottom, you can actually download for free. Now, it lets you offer them some money. I never have. But, you know, you can always do that. So we are not, you know, trying to push these on you. They are both free services. Yeah.
We don't get 10 cents every time someone navigates to this website. So we're not pushing anything. But it does provide some posters and some printouts of all kinds of logical fallacies. I have one of them up in the wall in my classroom, and I often point to it when discussing things in class to remind them of these logical fallacies. But most importantly, again, the Constitutional Rights Foundation has the conspiracy theory, past and present lesson, as well as many other great lessons, three more of which we will be going over in the coming month. One will also include a role play simulation, and two others include a tactic that we call civil conversations, one of Regina and I's favorite tools to use in the classroom that is based on, I wouldn't say just primary sources, but documents that we go over in class, and the idea of having your beliefs but using documents to ground those beliefs and pointing to evidence. So on behalf of
having a civil discourse.
Yeah, and being able to discuss things civilly. Like, I didn't know people were capable of doing that, but turns out that we're supposed to help our students be able to do that. Because the representation that we see of ourselves on television constantly is not all that accurate. And we need to remind students that the image of ourselves as a society that we have been shown over and over again in recent history, it's really not that accurate, but may make people think that it is, and then they might act accordingly. It's just not the case. So please utilize these resources. And on behalf of me, Ben Conklin,
Regina Yunt,
and Regina Yunt, we thank you for joining us tonight as attendees and participants in this webinar. And we really look forward to seeing some of you and others who you will share this experience with in our next webinar. So please look for the information on specific dates and times of these webinars. And thank you so much for joining us. And I hope we gave you a great lesson and you see value in this and incorporate it in your pedagogy moving forward.